We receive a lot of messages and texts from different sources, but it's always good that we get to know only from an expert and to seek expert advice and to follow them. This is Aster Volunteers COVID-19 web series and a special mention on respiratory patients and the myths and facts. And we have an expert panel of doctors with us here. First, let me introduce Dr. Vijayan Solangi, pulmonologist, Aster Medical Center, Qatar, and Dr. Jobin Rajan Benjamin from Aster Hospital. He's an internal medicine specialist. Hello, doctors. Hello. Welcome to the show. To start off with the pulmonologist, doctor, the question to you is, on a pulmonologist angle, if you could let us know, how is COVID-19 affecting the people who are with lung disorders?
Okay, Rashmi, see, the COVID is a respiratory disease primarily. It's an acute respiratory infection. And as such, whatever data we have, the people having respiratory conditions are not behaving differently than people who are not having respiratory diseases. The standard risk factor, like people who are elderly, people who are having diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, kidney disease, and the severe respiratory disease, they are at more risk of developing severe COVID.
Yes, doctor.
If mild COVID is concerned, like I am, they are at same risk as any other healthy person is. So I will say that the respiratory patients who are having mild to moderate respiratory disease, they should not be very much worried about that they are more prone to develop COVID early, or they will develop serious COVID disease.
Okay, doctor. Are people with respiratory diseases more likely to get the infection, or how is the percentage of it?
How will you get infection will depend upon how are you practicing your personal hygiene, like social distancing, hand washing, how often do you touch your mouth, nose, eyes, and how often do you come in contact with people who are having this disease. It's a disease which is spreading from one person to another person. So it's mainly dependent upon your personal hygiene and the level of transmission in your community. Like if you are in a state of too much infection in the community, you are more prone to develop the infection. But I would say that anybody in these times, like in Qatar or in UAE or in India, they should potentially consider themselves a person who can get COVID infection. But patients who are having respiratory disease, they are not at special risk for acquiring the infection. Their risk of acquiring infection is same as other person.
Okay, doctor. Doctor, the next question being, are there any additional measures that people should take to limit the risk of getting sick as they have a lung condition?
Yeah, this is very important, because people who are having serious lung conditions, they should know that their lung reserves are already small. So if they develop, they get another insult with COVID-19 disease, they may develop serious disease. So they have to be more cautious. So some people who are having mild disease like asthma, they are using their inhalers and they are symptomatically well, and there's no problem. They should follow all those kind of etiquettes and social distancing principles which are told by local authorities or WHO or any authentic site. Those people who are having severe respiratory disease like severe COPD or bronchiectasis, who are symptomatic despite having best of the treatment, they should be really concerned about their condition. They should try to do isolation at least for coming weeks. Social distancing alone will not be sufficient for them.
Right.
And when they are in some sort of isolation at their home, they should be avoiding close contact with other people in the household, because other people in household may be going out and acquiring infection from outside. They may be asymptomatic and they may be giving this infection to the person who is having the severe respiratory disease.
Okay. So transmission is
transmission. Transmission rate is same, but if they get disease, there is a chance that they will get more severe disease. Like if their lungs are already damaged,
right.
If they develop COVID, if they develop small patch of pneumonia, they will be more sick. They will require hospitalization, they will require oxygen.
The intensity will be more.
And the intensity will be more of their symptoms. And therefore, they have to be particularly cautious of avoiding this infection. So for that, social distancing alone will not be sufficient.
Mm-hmm.
They should try to isolate themselves for at least for coming weeks in their house, and then within house also they should avoid contact with even healthy people who are coming from outside.
Okay, doctor. Many people with asthma and lung disease regularly have dry cough. So is it possible for you to understand the difference between the dry cough that is normal and the dry cough or the symptom that comes out of COVID-19?
See, asthma, anybody, any person who is having a chronic disease like asthma, he knows what is the symptomatology of that particular disease.
Mm.
So he should very peculiarly see if his symptoms have increased, and that increase is unusual. Like if he is having a cough intensity of 5 out of 10 most often, and if it has suddenly become 9 to 10, like his cough has worsened.
Mm-hmm.
He should be worried about that he may have acquired something extra than his original disease. And since COVID-19 is an infection, so there will be symptoms of infection like fever, body ache, sore throat, and other symptoms. As there will be something unusual, there will be something, some extra symptoms.
Mm-hmm.
And a person should see those persons who are having respiratory diseases, those who are having regular symptoms. If their symptoms are usual, or they have become unusual, or they have really worsened a lot, and if there is really an signs of infection like fever, viral infection like flu-like illness, body ache, joint pains, a sore throat, and they are reporting some new symptoms like loss of smell, loss of taste, these symptoms also one should see.
Okay, these are some of the symptoms that is
the new symptoms
that stay away from.
Yeah.
Okay, doctor. Should people with lung disease and under medication increase the normal dosage of the treatment or the medicine? How is that? Do you usually increase the dosage if you come across that this person has been affected?
Oh, I meet a lot of asthma patients these days, and they ask that since asthma medicine contains steroids, and they hear from here and there that steroids make them immunocompromised, or if they can develop more COVID disease if they use these medicines regularly. I would like to tell them, there is no reason to increase their medication, but at the same time, they should not reduce their medication.
Okay.
Even if those medicines are containing steroids, they should continue taking it, because if their asthma is not under control, and if they get COVID infection, their lung will be doubly damaged.
Okay.
They will be having an uncontrolled asthma. At the same time, they will be having a COVID. So a disease which will run mild symptomatology in 80% of the cases, they will get into that category of patients where the symptoms are high and where again they need to be hospitalized.
Mm-hmm.
And it will be an unnecessary hospitalization. Had they been using their asthma medicines regularly, their symptoms would not have been worsened so much.
Yeah, right. Is there any long-term damage for the lungs in case if you are affected by COVID-19?
See, Rashmi, we are still in a process of learning this disease. In fact, everybody is learning, and we yet do not have that much of data. Long-term means long-term. This disease is still 3 months old.
Okay.
So we really don't know what is long-term, but people who become asymptomatic, who become virologically negative, they have persistent cough even after their disease spectrum is over for 2-3 weeks.
Okay.
And those who develop a lot of pneumonias, there will be a residual scarring of their lungs. Their lung may get a bit smaller, like other severe pneumonias. And those who have developed ARDS, there may be a lot of residual lung fibrosis, lung scarring.
Okay.
Their lungs may get a bit smaller.
Shrinking.
That may be one of the long-term complications. And as such, if you have developed a severe COVID, so you will be hospitalized, you will be immobilized. So there are other kind of long-term issues you will always have with COVID-19 disease.
If you could let us know the preventive measures that we should take, in case if you are using a nebulizer regularly. There will be some people who are using it.
Okay, for nebulizer or for spacer, or people who are using CPAP machines overnight,
right,
or those people who are on long-term oxygen
support.
There is no particular kind of thing. You have to use those things in a hygienic way, like you should always clean those orifices which are touched by your mouth.
Mm-hmm.
You can use alcohol swabs. And another thing is, these apparatuses, these devices should be individualized. For if there are two patients in house which need to use nebulizers, they both should have
different
two nebulizers.
Yeah.
It should not be like you are using same inhaler by two persons. this is all that is needed. And whenever you are using them, you use simple hygienic method like wash your
just
hands
wash it,
and just
right.
clean the or things whichever is touched by mouth by some alcohol swab or like this.
Okay, doctor. Doctor, if you could let us know anything that as a pulmonologist, what is your take on this? How we should take care in general, not only the people who have got respiratory issues, in general for some people, what we need to take care?
Oh, see, everybody is telling what we need to take care. Number
right.
one is
but
number
from
one
a
is,
pulmonologist
yeah.
view.
Number one is number one is we should try to avoid acquiring the infection, and number two is we should try to avoid spreading the infection, because these days there is a talk that people may be, a large number may be asymptomatic, and they may be spreading the infection even not even by coughing or sneezing, by loud talking also. So there are so many new things coming out, and there are things like if you are going to a crowded setup, should all people wear masks? These new concepts are really emerging. So I think we are still at a phase, most of us, where we can go for preventive aspects for COVID to acquire the infection.
Okay,
anyway, and on the other side, even people like people, some people have speculation that ultimately a large population will be suffering with this disease with either this season or that season or coming seasons. So we have to understand this disease mechanics. It is mild disease for 80% of people. So this is really not a thing to get very much panicked about it. But let us be cautious. Let us try to prevent acquiring the infection as well as spreading the infection.
Spreading of the infection. Thank you so much, Doctor. Now we are going to Dr. Jobin Rajan Benjamin, who is an internal specialist from Aster Hospital, Qatar. And Doctor will be talking to us about the myths and facts of COVID-19. Doctor, to start off, the vaccine has been developed against COVID-19 and it is yet to be released. That is the usual talk that we hear from social media. Doctor will talk to us about the myths and facts about it.
Unfortunately, Rashmi, it's a myth. So far, up to date, there is no vaccinations that has been found or no treatment line that has been developed. So that is why we are very much particular in maintaining the hand hygiene, personal hygiene, social distancing. So at present, there is no vaccination. Maybe development is going on, but nothing right now fruitful has developed so far.
Okay, doctor. There's a myth that even if you would have symptoms, you can still be contagious. So what is your take on that, doctor?
I would correct the question. Even if you don't have symptoms, you can still be contagious. That is
okay.
where the, and I would say it is a fact. See, right now what we are facing is around 20-30% of people, they are actually asymptomatic, or we call them in terms as silent carriers.
Mm-hmm.
So these silent carriers, they can be either pre-symptomatic or asymptomatic. Pre-symptomatic is a condition you face just before you get the symptoms. It's for 5 to 7 days, they can be shedding the virus, they can be giving along, which is why this disease becomes so much contagious all around. So when they come in contact with other people and everything, the disease keeps spreading. Yes, so it is very true. That is why many countries are practicing lockdowns, or we are actually asking people to stay at home, because they might be falling under the category of silent carriers or coming in contact with these silent carriers.
Okay, doctor. Since we are live, we have a few viewers who have asked this question. Mm-hmm. And there's a question from Sai Khan Sarkar. Does COVID-19 affect smokers more? Are smokers more susceptible to it? Herbal smokers also? Are there any precautions to be taken? For people who smoke horticulture coconations, I'm worried about a friend.
Maybe I will just answer that question. Doctor had told it very elaborately right now.
Right.
But I'll just put it in simple words. See, normally when we are in childhood days, we all have races, isn't it? So when we are standing in a line, there will be always few people who might be standing just few meters ahead of us. So what is the advantage for them is they complete the race faster. It's something similar to
right.
that. But this is not a race we want to complete. So what happens is people who are having respiratory diseases or people who are smokers, chronic smokers, they are already having a bit of lung damage going on. So they are much ahead in the race. And so their chance for getting into a respiratory problem is much faster. The symptoms are more. They get more sick and diseased faster. So this is not a race we want to complete. And you are ahead is not an advantage for you, rather it's a disadvantage. So smoking, any kind of horticulture, non-horticulture, vaping, e-cigarettes, whatever you say, it is not good. And if he is my friend, I would advise him to stop smoking.
Okay.
And the data is clearly against smokers, and whatever experience so far we have, smokers have developed serious disease.
In future.
Yeah, no, in this COVID.
Presently also,
okay.
Yes.
And one question to you, doctor. How do I build my immunity for respiratory ailments during COVID-19?
Are there no specific methods to build your immunity for acquiring this, even including that high doses of vitamin C?
Mm-hmm.
Means you have to lead a healthy hygienic life and social distancing and hand hygiene, that all should do, and eat well and exercise regularly.
Okay,
whatever standard things you do for good health, you should keep on doing. There are no special measures. Eating some vitamin pill or those things, or eating too much protein, or those things will not help.
Okay, doctor. Doctor, going to the myths and facts.
Mm-hmm.
The coronavirus pandemic won't end once warmer weather arrives. Is that so?
That currently, yes, it is a fact, because you know, right now we are facing a pandemic, and pandemics normally don't follow the current situations or the scenario as we face in normal flus. So yes, in warmer climates normally the flus and all comes down. But right now we don't have any evidences, because it's a pandemic being spread along all the places, and a lot of people are traveling here and there. So current, no evidences shows that warmer climates, the virus's growth would be less.
Mm-hmm.
So at present, we should still follow the methods what the governments or the health authorities have told to us, and remain socially distant. And even warmer climates, all you're doing, stay at home, not to go out.
Okay, doctor. Vaccines for pneumonia protect against COVID-19. Is there any relation between that?
Vaccines for pneumonia protects against pneumonia, not against COVID.
But there is
COVID-19.
A talk, because the social media forces us to, you know, take into account all these questions.
We do ask people who are having respiratory compromise or respiratory, they are not compliant, to take the pneumonia vaccines. Same thing as I said before, because for them, once they get these pneumonias, they are more prone for superadded infection or immunologically
True.
Weak to get other infections.
Mm-hmm.
So we do ask them to practice. But otherwise, for COVID, these vaccines are nothing in particular of going to be of any use.
Okay. And the next question is again, how effective are thermal scanners in detecting people infected with the new coronavirus?
This is a question asked by a lot of people once they come. The moment we check their temperature and we say there is no fever, so they keep telling, like, you know, that means there is no COVID. No, thermal scanners are basically checking your fevers or your temperature,
like
of
body
your
temperature.
Body. Yes. It is one of the symptoms of COVID virus. It's a symptom. So it doesn't mean your thermal scanners are showing there is no fever. It doesn't mean you are not a carrier or you are not infected.
It can be the vice versa too, right?
It can be the vice versa also.
Like if somebody has taken paracetamol before you
yes.
have checked it.
Yes.
Or if somebody is coming from a car and his AC was just
blowing
over his
on
forehead.
His yes.
So it will not be. It's a mass screening, right,
yes.
kind of a thing.
Right.
If you, it's a cheap method to do.
Many do that just for traveling purpose, because they just
it's
wanted
a mass
to meet.
Kind of a thing.
Yeah.
So it can be
it's
done
yeah.
quickly and
currently
easily.
When a lot of people are there, it is one of the measures that they can take, because there is no other options for us.
And doctor, viewers have asked one more question. It is from Mr. Paul Matthew. Is it okay for people with respiratory illness to take small walks outside their homes, or is it better to be indoor all the time?
Small walks?
Yeah.
What is small? I didn't get the question.
He just wanted to know, he has got respiratory illness, but is it okay whether he can go for a small walk outside, or he should stay indoors?
It depends on what level of transmission you are having in the community and what your local authorities are telling you and what kind of lung illness you have. Like if you are having a severe lung disease, bronchiectasis or very severe COPD or very severe ILD,
mm-hmm.
And if there is a lot of transmission in your community, then of course you should not go even for once to the shop for walk or exercise like what they have recommending in UK. In UK also they are recommending people who are having mild disease, they can go for walk once a day, and those who are having severe disease, they should not go for even for walk
mm-hmm.
for coming weeks.
Okay, doctor. There is one more question from Mr. Divakar Ram.
Mm-hmm.
Could a CT scan or a radiograph help any bronchial or asthmatic patient help understand if they have they are COVID suspects?
No, CT scan or radiological evidences, it is to indicate whether you are having any problem with your lungs. So these evidences can come for many diseases, not necessarily COVID has any particular disease pattern or anything. So it is not a clinical criteria for identification for COVID. We do that alongside with other symptoms, the history and other clinical features. It helps to add up to the diagnosis.
Okay, back to the myths and facts. All COVID-19 cases are severe and fatal.
No, that sir has also explained earlier. All COVID cases are not severe and fatal. 80% of the people go along with just mild flu or flu-like symptoms. 20% goes to stage 2 or stage 3 where they are having respiratory problems.
Mm-hmm.
And in that 6% of people, according to the current evidences, go for very critical or severe respiratory problems. Otherwise, all COVID cases are not fatal.
Okay, doctor. And there is one more question. Usually people say the hand dryers
mm-hmm.
will kill the virus. Is that so, doctor?
How
these are all
I
the
wish,
myths what we get.
I wish it was so easy, but Reshmi, no, it doesn't kill the bacteria or the viruses, as they say. Because if you just take virus COVID, for instance, if technically in lab you have to inhalate it, you need around 56 degrees centigrade temperature for over 15 minutes at 10,000 units. That's a very high temperature you're talking about.
Right.
To inhalate this thing. I don't think any hairdryer can give such kind of thing, and if at all it gives, it's not something that you should be practiced because your face is going for a ride with that.
Okay, doctor. There is again one more question. Certain information sources says the virus can float around in the air for hours. Is that so?
Well, it's a controversial issue still, but we have to take it that the virus could be airborne. It can stay in the air for a couple of hours at least. We have to see, these things are pure science kind of studies. They are yet to be done. But there are indications that this may be even airborne. Means if somebody has coughed here, this virus may stay in the air for a couple of hours and someone can come and inhale it. This is
mm-hmm.
possible.
Okay.
It depends on your immunity, because normally once you cough or sneeze, you don't expect the particles just to fall off on the ground.
True.
It would be there.
Yeah.
Especially in air-conditioned surroundings, you know, you should be a bit more careful. So that is one of the reasons we are, so far current studies have not shown anything, but we have certain cases to tell that it can be airborne also.
This is third accepted mode of
transmission.
For COVID
yeah.
now.
Right.
Okay. And there is one more question from Mr. Vinod Kuriakos. Latest evidence shows people with low vitamin D are prone for severe ARDS. What is your option?
No, that is also a bit, it's all clinical based evidence kind of thing. See, normally all these, we take a large number of people. We do take a large number of studies and with this. But most of these studies, there will be, we cannot tell they are isolated with vitamin D deficiency alone. There might be a lot of other factors alongside. So currently, according to the current evidences, we cannot completely tell vitamin D is the only cause, or it's a primitive cause, it's a pivotal cause for ARDS. Yes, maybe people with that, they would have concomitantly found vitamin D to be less, but no, we cannot tell 100% that it is because of that.
And surprisingly, COVID-19, ARDS is not really a big problem. Very small number of patients are going till ARDS. It's bilateral pneumonias that is the main problem.
Exactly.
The ARDS is not a real problem so far in COVID-19 disease.
Okay. Viewers, you're watching Aster Volunteers webinar series. Kindly post in your queries and expert panel will be answering all your queries. And next, going to one more question of Mr. Sanish. What are the benefits of taking vitamin C and vitamin D? Will it reduce the risk of ARDS?
Oh, no, no. It's even the best of studies, serious studies, it has just shown that even high doses of vitamin C are safe to give. But so far, I mean, the evidence is not that vitamin C should be taken. And if you consider vitamin C, the way it has been used in the studies, it's in grams, and it's a huge load of doses. You cannot supplement in that way while sitting at your houses. And that study, citrus study, has also not proved a very large benefit. It has only proved that it is safe to be given. It's still a theoretical possibility. There's no evidence that vitamin C supplement or vitamin D supplement, even in the large doses, can prevent you from acquiring ARDS. Probably they may reduce some severity of the ARDS, but as such, it has no preventive role.
Vitamin C is a preventive medicine we give for normally cold. So it's more of a preventive line.
Measured.
It is not a treatment measure. So you taking that during a disease process, so far, like as sir has said, there has been no evidence for that.
Even for prevention.
Prevention also.
So they have studied, you know, one of the studies,
this thing.
Soups and vitamin C. Soups
exactly.
Found to be more preventive and soothing for your eyes.
Exactly.
One question from Mr. Saikat Sarkar. Is it right that if I don't have any chronic disease, I am basically safe? I am 34 years old.
Oh, no.
No.
Oh, of course
not. Age has nothing to do with
this.
It.
This American experience is showing that, of course, the older the person having underlying medical disease, they are more prone to develop severe disease. But young people are not immune. There's a significant fit young people who have ventilator and die.
Exactly.
Okay.
Nobody is immune.
One question from viewer Mr. P. Vishnu. Can COVID-19 be cured with homeopathy treatment?
So, the Charles in UK, the prince,
he has
propagated, and I think this was then only it was rejected by NHS. Of course, even allopathy does not have the treatment for it.
Currently, no. That is what we can tell, evidence-based. Then, see, as sir has said, it's a relatively new disease, newer virus. We are learning a lot of things. So, maybe later on, we cannot tell, but currently, no.
Okay, doctor. Can we reuse a mask? If so, how many times? This is from Mr. Sriraj.
No.
Okay.
It depends. See, the problem is currently now with the deficiencies of masks and a lot of problems going on. It depends on how you handle the mask, how you can use it. See, right now I do tell a lot of people, the problem is now the masks are becoming more infectious because they remove the mask, they keep it somewhere. And you know that place would have been contaminated with corona, and they just wear it directly on the nose. It's like it's easily you're asking for trouble.
You're inviting trouble.
You are inviting.
I would like to add Rashmi in this mask issue. Okay, so see, there are mask issues very controversial. It's dynamically changing day by day basis. Okay, so the mask has two purposes. One is preventing yourself getting infected, and other is spreading infection to others. Right. So for yourself getting infected, you need to have that N95 of kind of mask.
Mm-hmm.
And that you need when you are doing some kind of a medical procedure where they say that aerosolization procedure, like if you are intubating somebody, if you are doing some CPR, if you are doing some nebulization, those kind of things when you need N95 mask. Otherwise, this simple mask, surgical mask, is sufficient. That is to prevent spreading of contagion from you to other people.
Exactly.
And now, like in India, there is a campaign going on, home-based
masks.
Because we don't have that much of mask in the market. And on the reusability also, if you can decontaminate those masks by putting them in a bleach or by some, like, in my hospital, in my unit, I see there's a problem of getting adequate number of masks. Supply is a big issue, at least till a few days back it was a big issue. I was asking people to iron those masks and reuse them.
Reuse.
Wash them and iron and reuse them. We have to develop dynamic things in these times.
Okay. There is one more question from Haripriya. Certain studies say that few COVID-19 affected people will have no symptoms. Is this possible?
Yes, that's what we told earlier. There are silent carriers, or we call as asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic carriers. They have normally no symptoms at all. And any diseases, there is an incubation period after which only they might get symptoms. Sometimes they might get no symptoms at all and it just goes off.
Doctor, there is one question from Ms. Gautami. I hear that infection can be prevented using herbal extracts and Ayurvedic and homeopathic medicines. Should I believe this?
No. Big no.
Okay.
Currently, no.
The questions are flowing, so it's very difficult for me to read one by one. But surely we will be answering all your queries. In case if I have missed something, we will be answering it. And okay, in the European region, why the rate of death is high as compared to Asian regions?
Okay, it's because, you know, there are two theories about it. One, they may have a different strain of virus, one. And another is, since they are having more elderly population, especially like Italy.
Dependent.
And how robust is their healthcare system? And how exhausted is their healthcare system? Like if you have a robust healthcare system for 25 people, and if you get 50 people for that kind of a treatment, so you may have very high death rates. But like similar kind of population is there in Italy and Germany, so some people are speculating there may be a change in the strain also of the virus.
Okay, doctor.
And genetic susceptibility also.
Okay. One question from again Mr. Paul Matthew. People who are allergic to pollen, what precaution should they take?
They should take their anti-asthma medicine, anti-allergic medicines, regularly,
if required.
Okay,
as
doctor.
Usual.
And a question from Poonam Rao. How would I know I'm carrying the COVID-19 virus if I am asymptomatic?
You can only do testing for that. And in that also, currently you are having the nasal swab testing. That's what commonly we do for mass testing. But then again, it is not 100%. We cannot tell if it comes positive, it's positive, or there are false negatives, there are false positives. So it's only around 60 to 70% positivity we get. So that is one of the reasons why we keep telling everybody to stay at home, because we cannot test for each and everybody. Because when we go for a mass testing, there might be people who require it more, and we won't be able to, the kits wouldn't be available because it's a pandemic. The entire world needs it right now. So what you can do best is consider yourself to be infected. That's the best way, you know. So you prevent from getting and you prevent from
spreading
giving
it
also. So that is what in Chinese one official said. Take yourself as infected and act accordingly. So you stay at home.
Yes,
I have one answer for what her name. This lady?
Poonam.
Poonam. Poonam, soon we are going to have rapid antibody test. So, see, there's a large number of people who may be asymptomatic and might have corona infection. So, this can be detected by this antibody screening.
Okay.
So, this rapid test.
Okay. There's one more question, doctor, from Mr. Amir. How often should I use hand sanitizer while going to hypermarket? Once or twice? Before entering the shop and after purchasing? Please advise.
Before touching up, after touching any surface that is potentially contaminated.
Okay.
Any surface.
Okay,
if he hasn't touched any surface, anything, there's no need. But if he has touched any desk, this and that, so he has to.
Simple before and after should do the
trick. Okay, there's one interesting question by Mr. Divakar. If one can hold their breath for more than 10 seconds, can I consider to be safe?
No. No. It's like certain things that they go. A lot of people come and tell, you know, I don't think I'm having COVID because I was able to hold my breath for 10 seconds. It's just testing your lungs capacity. And 10 seconds holding your
nothing
breath, it's not testing your capacity of lung also. It's got nothing to do with COVID.
Okay, doctor. Now, I think I will go to your myth. Doctor, the social media has given us lot of information, lot of inputs on so many things that we are forced to believe. So what is your take on that? And as a take-home message to the viewers, what would you like to share?
See, basically, right now, COVID is a pandemic that everybody knows. Even my five-year-old daughter tells me, you know, Corona, that is what it's. So it is a battle, and it is a relatively new battle. Yes, we have had a lot of diseases and we have fought through, and there are lots of new lines of theories and a lot of things coming up. But the basic or the bottom line is, so far there is no treatment for it. So right now, prevention is our only way we can fight this battle. There are a lot of people who are fighting this. There are healthcare authorities, there are health officials, there are governments. Everybody is trying their bit. So my request is, or I urge, we can fight this battle together, everybody, because this is not a battle that can be fought alone. So all who are watching or all who are there, stay at home, listen to what, maintain personal hygiene, social distancing, respiratory hygiene, all the advices, not the negativity. Be positive, we can win, we have won many battles. We can win this also. God help, God willingly, we will come out victorious. But just listen to this and stay safe, be at home. Like as I said before, consider yourself to be infected and behave accordingly. So you don't spread to others and you don't get also.
Okay. Many questions are there, doctor. So I will just ask you one more question. It is from Ms. Reena. The pH of coronavirus ranges from 5.5 to 8.5. This info is being forwarded in WhatsApp. Do alkaline foods destroy the virus? Is it another myth?
Oh, come on. No. See, I don't know about the pH of coronavirus, but by eating anything alkaline or acidic food, it is not going to help killing the virus because it is not in the stomach. It is in the lungs in your...
We are talking about a cellular kind of thing, you know, intracellularly.
It is, cells,
not a gut
not
bacteria
outside.
We are talking about.
Okay. There is one question from Haripriya. There are a lot of pharmaceutical companies and homeo clinics that have started to sell COVID-19 protection sanitizers and COVID-19 immune building tablets. Will they help?
Sanitizers, if they have the alcohol content, as said in
more
that,
than 70%.
Okay. But otherwise, no, I don't think so.
Okay, to the pulmonologist, is it safe to breathe air coming out of AC where the filter is not cleaned? Will it affect him in this scenario?
See, again, it's same question, whether it is airborne or not, it's aerosolized or not. So if you are in an unventilated place, whether it is air conditioned or not air conditioned, if it is unventilated, you have to understand unventilated, there is no exchange of air, means the air is not going outside and fresh air is not coming in. And if this person has had somebody who had COVID and if he has coughed and sneezed, of course, there is a good chance that you can acquire infection while breathing in that room.
Okay. What is the incubation period of coronavirus disease? This is asked by Abdul Rahman.
So they say one is median incubation period, it's 5 to 7 days. Then there is a usual
incubation period.
Is 12 days. But the incubation period of more than 20 days has also been reported. Okay. So it's a 5, 6, 7 days, 12 days, 14 days, or 20 days, up
that
to 20
days. That
is
why one of the reasons, even if the patient has been tested negative, for the COVID, we are still asking them to remain at home for 14 days.
Even after they have passed quarantine.
After they have discharged from the hospital.
See, 12 days is maximum incubation period notice in most of the studies, right? So 2 days extra, 14 days quarantine they are put at. But in some cases, even more incubation period has been found to be more than 20 days also. So 14 days in quarantine, 14 days at home.
Okay. One question from Haripal Singh. 76% of India's COVID-19 patients are men, according to a Ministry of Health release. Why does this virus discriminate on gender? Is it so?
Yes, it has discriminated a bit on gender. Men have got more severe disease, no doubt. But that figure is not like 76 or 34%.
Yeah.
It is not that big. It's just 60%, 40% kind. But see, men are roaming more on the street.
Exactly. Like that is what they are more roaming
chance
more on
of
the street.
Acquiring
carrier
infection
is more.
Yes,
yeah,
like
getting
this.
It.
So
okay.
Far, there's no conclusive data. But men are more prone to have severe disease also.
Okay. And there's one more question from Mr. Neeraj Sharma. For COPD patients, how do you think home remedies like turmeric, ginger, lemon tea will boost their immunity and probably will
for
they
nobody,
go for it?
For nobody, for that matter. Mm. For COPD is not a special case, but for nobody these remedies will work. And for COPD, of course, it won't work.
So viewers, I think I have answered all the queries. So in between, in case if you have missed it, we will have our doctors answer all their queries. And doctor, as a closing note, would you like to give any comments to the viewers?
Okay. What I observe in my patients, something which I want that they should correct. Number one is people are still having this kind of cough habit. So I want people should stop this kind of a habit while they are coughing. Try to cover your cough with an elbow. This is one thing. Second thing, what I observe when people come to my clinic, they touch on the desk, they put their mobile over there. So I like that you should keep your hands preserved as your eyes, you know. You should keep them protected. You should not be touching here and there if it is not required. Like people generally have habit while putting hands like this when sitting somewhere or keeping hands on the chair like this. I have noticed this.
The mask is something like that. What they come, remove the mask, they put it on the table.
Yeah. And mask also. Mm. Even I have got a change in my ideas. Mm. Earlier I was thinking that these kind of masks are of no use who are not having disease. Mm. But during this epidemic, I have learned that masking patients at a large scale also may be one of
useful.
The part of the solution of
right.
pandemics like this. Like if you are going to a crowded setting like all of us are there, you should ideally be put on some kind of a mask, which could be homemade, which could be a simple cloth. It does not need to be a
surgical
mask.
Simple
and of course,
good.
The same question. If you can reuse them, but you have to sterilize them in whatever way possible.
Okay,
be careful how you handle the mask.
Yeah.
Doctor, speaking about the mask, just a closing question. Mm. What is your suggestion on the disposal of masks?
Normally, right now, what we tell is if you can just put it in a plastic cover or something and you can give it to your nearby medical units or something for them to dispose of as a biological waste,
yes.
would be the best option.
Best option.
Otherwise, there is one more easy solution, a bleach solution.
Yeah.
We get a Clorox
yes,
in the market.
Yes, it's available
so,
in the market.
So you can dip that mask before throwing in any kind of this thing. So that Clorox solution, which is available in our supermarkets, 1 in 5 part, 1 cup of Clorox, 4 cup of simple
water.
Plain water. Mm-hmm. You make this solution, keep it in your house. You can use this also for cleaning your surfaces. And you can dip that mask and then dip in a simple dustbin also. You can do this also.
Okay. Thank you so much, doctors. Thank you so much for your time. As the global tagline, stay home, stay safe. Thank you so much.